Hello everyone, welcome to the exam review of FRM part 1 and part 2 conducted on the Jan 16th. So finally, after waiting for around 6 to 7 months, exam was conducted in India and in other countries also. But in most of the cases, exam is deferred again to May. So for all those students who deferred their exam to May, who appeared for the exam on the 16th of Jan, or you appeared for the exam on November or October. So this is the combined exam review of FRM part 1 and part 2 both. And I will mainly focus on the 16th Jan exam, but I will give you some feedback of previous exams as well. So in this exam, I have some important discussions to make unlike the previous exam reviews. Because in previously in 2019, say in November 2019 or May 2019, exam was more or less same compared to the previous exam. So there was nothing much to discuss. Here in 2020, we have a lot of things to discuss. There are a few changes. Major changes are for the FRM part 2 and some changes are for the FRM part 1. Mainly in the time required to finish your exam. This is the major difference for FRM part 1 and FRM part 2. So let's first start with the FRM part 1 and then we move into the FRM part 2. I recommend FRM part 2 students to watch both the discussions, FRM part 1 and FRM part 2 both. And if you are in FRM part 1, of course, you will appear for the FRM part 2 in May 2021. So yeah, so you should watch complete session, right? So what we will see in this session, what is the area, agenda of the discussion? So we will see the exam, first of all, FRM part 1, we'll start with the FRM part 1. We will see exam pattern, then the questions composition and the time management. Okay, time management, the exam was the most crucial part of this exam. So let's first start with the FRM's exam pattern. One more note, I will not discuss the exact questions here, okay? Exact questions as in which questions were there in the 2016 exam, because it is not right to share the exam questions, but we will see what were the pattern, what was the pattern of the exam and how you can prepare or how you can strategize your preparation for the coming exam. Okay, so let's start with the first, the exam pattern of the FRM part 1 is the total questions 100. Then duration was 4 hours, pen and paper mode. This is the last pen and paper mode exam for the FRM part 1. In May, you have CBT, computer based testing in 2021, right? And exam was conducted on 16th of Jan 2021. This is deferred exam of 2020 sessions of May and the November combined and conducted on the 16th of Jan. It was primarily conducted in the India and some other countries, okay? So let's see, first of all, the composition of the exam, questions composition. So first subject wise, you got 20% from book one. This is already provided by the GAAP that they will give 20% weightage to the book one and book two and 30% weightage each to book three and book four. Okay, so quantity analysis 20%, FMP 30% and VRM, valuation and risk models, not war. Don't call the subject war. War is just three chapters of this section. VRM, valuation risk model subject, 30% questions, which means 20 questions from this, 20 questions from this, 30 questions from this and 30 questions from this, total 100 questions. Now, proportion of theory to calculative questions. Now, theory to calculative questions were around 50-50. One important note here, this is based on the student's feedback. So this might be like say 45 to 55, and again same is applicable for here, 45 to 55. This might deviate based on like 5 questions plus or minus, but more or less this was a 50-50 exam, theory and calculative questions. Now understand one particular thing about the theory questions and the calculative questions. So what is the meaning of the calculative question, what is the meaning of the theory question? So you have some calculative portion in your syllabus. Like the calculation of value at risk, option pricing is the calculative area, and a lot of other things are there. Then you have quantity analysis, which is majorly a calculative area, and so on. This calculative area covers the calculative concept, and the questions were calculative, where you are supposed to find out the final answer. Answer will be numeric or decision based, but mainly numeric, and where you are supposed to, you are required to use the calculator or the calculative concept. This means the calculative area. Then comes the theoretical portion. In theoretical portion, we can divide this particular part in two parts, two sections, 15 questions and the remaining, okay, 35 questions. These 15 questions are theory questions on the calculative area. Theory on calculative area. So the example of theory question on the calculative area is, say you have value at risk section in your syllabus, okay, where you are supposed to calculate the VAR. But GAAP sometimes asks questions which are theory based. You have to interpret the formula and give the explanation based on the theory. The question is drafted in theory. Answers are in theory. All the four options are in theory. But that concept is calculative concept. So you have formula in your syllabus. So if you understand that formula, then you can answer these 15 questions easily. If you don't understand the formula, if you just remember the formula and don't understand the formula, then answering these 15 questions becomes very difficult. Then you have 35 questions which are purely theoretical, meaning the theory in concept and theory in question. This is the major problem, okay, major problem for students in every exam. And same was applicable for 2020 exam. I'm calling 2021 16th exam as a 16 Jan exam as a 2020 exam. Okay, so the problem was there. A lot of students were complaining about the theory section. But remember one thing. If you manage this particular part, the calculative area, properly with say 95% accuracy, and it can be achieved, the 95% accuracy can be achieved in the exam, because once you know the concept, once you understand the concept properly, getting answers in the exam is not that difficult. You have to, of course, there are some tricks in the questions you have to apply, or you have to understand those tricks. Apart from those tricks, you can easily score in these questions, okay? So you have to make sure in your further preparation, if you are appearing for say May 2021, then you have to focus on this particular area, calculative area. And this calculative area is the core area. Okay. You can understand. If you open the chapter, you will be able to understand that this is the core area of the chapter. And chances are very high that you will get question from that core area only. Okay. Then next is the theory portion. Now, for 15 questions, in-depth understanding is required for all concepts. So we cannot predict like what will be the theory question, what type of theory question to expect on the calculative area, because there are a lot of variations possible. So you can gauge the depth of the concept or the depth of the question only after seeing that question and sitting in the exam. So if you know the concepts, then your chances of correcting the right answer improves drastically. Okay. Next is the 35 questions which are purely theory and theory, that is theory in concept, theory in questions. This is very tricky part. There is no way, okay, there is no way in preparation you can make sure that you are going to tick all the questions right, or even with say 90% or 80% accuracy, because it totally depends upon two factors. Okay, the first factor is how you remember the concepts. Okay, if you are able to remember the concepts, then of course you will be able to tick more questions, because even in these 35 questions, you will get some direct questions. 5 to 10 questions will be direct. Say I'm just taking an example, the rough idea. So 5 to 10 questions will be direct. If you remember the concept, then you have to just tick the answer. So say chapter financial disaster. Okay, so in financial disaster, the questions were very direct. In this exam, 2020 exam, and I have seen since 2016, in all the exams, in majority of the exams, the questions were direct. So if you remember the concepts, you will be able to answer those questions. Okay, so for this, my general preference is like you should go for some short notes. Okay, I generally don't recommend studying theory from very detailed book. At the end, the concept is like, you're supposed to remember the concept. If you study from the detailed books where the concepts are discussed in very depth, then problem is what points you're supposed to remember. Okay, you will not be able to understand it. So to understand or to know that what points to remember, always prefer short notes if these notes are available for the students. And you can also create your own notes, prepare your own notes like this. So when you are doing your reading, just take note and make sure in the end, in the revision schedule before your exam, you should focus on these notes only. So all three questions, two or three questions were there, and all were from these three pages only. So in exam, in your syllabus, you have around 15 to 20 pages chapter on the financial disaster, and we zeroed down to reduced it to 3 pages. Okay. Now, I hope you are able to understand the importance here. So if you have just 3 pages to remember, it is easy for you to remember these 3 pages compared to the 20 pages. And questions were direct. So you will be able to score in this particular section. And similar incidences were there in the other chapters. So there are few chapters where you are likely to get direct questions. And there are few chapters where you will get questions which are focusing on the concepts. Now, just a second. Okay. Now the next section, which is around 20 questions. Here, the problem is, irrespective of which book you choose, GARP or any reading material, or even author's original book, doesn't matter. You are going to face the similar problem, because the problem is not with the concept. Problem is the way question is asked. Okay. So this particular section is very student specific. Some students are naturally good in understanding theory questions and answering those questions. So those students will get advantage in these questions. But remember, from my experience, I can tell you, we have around 10 to 20% maximum students who are so good with the theory portion that they will be able to answer with the high accuracy. More or less, students are same and their preparation level is same. And their attitude towards the theory question is same. So most of the students, if you are on some forums and all where students were discussing the exam, most of the students complained about the theory portion, right? So reason is because you have to handle those theory questions in exam, and there is no way you can prepare for those theory questions, meaning you are going to face the difficulty in those theory questions, right? So this is about the calculative and theory question. So finally, I will give the conclusion, what you are supposed to do for the coming exam. So make sure you prepare the core area properly with the conceptual clarity, practice enough, and make sure you are able to remember the concepts. Okay. Don't spread your preparation. You don't require in depth as in so you have say any particular concept. You don't need to know the derivations of those concepts. You need to understand the concept, purpose of the concept, and how it is applied, how that concept can be applied on the question. If you are able to understand these three parts, then you are good to go. Then next is these 15 questions which are coming on the calculative area. Again, the same rule is applicable here. So you have to simply understand the concept, and based on your theory interpretation, how good you are with the interpretation of the theory question, you will be able to answer it. Again, you cannot do much in these 15 questions as well, which are asked on the calculative questions. Next is the questions where you are supposed to remember the key points. Best way to answer these 15 questions is prepare short notes or use short notes. Okay. So if you are able to remember the key points, definitely you will be able to answer the questions. Okay. And next is the remaining 20 questions. Don't focus much on these questions. Just make sure you are ready. Okay. You know the concept, and sit in the exam and see if you can answer the questions. If you are able to answer it, good. If you are not able to answer it, you will be able to eliminate at least two options. Okay. You have A, B, C, D. And if you know the concept properly, then you can eliminate the two options easily. And then you have to guesswork between the remaining two options. This will improve your accuracy. If you don't know the concept, then there is a problem, because you will not be able to eliminate it. But again, it will not affect your result as long as you are doing good in this area. Okay. So let's move into the next discussion. This is about the difficulty level. So we are dividing the exam based on the difficulty level. This is again based on the student's report. Okay. So let's start with the first. I'll give you a quick overview. Around 30% questions were easy. Then medium difficulty level 35%, difficult questions were 30%, and unsolvable questions, like no matter what, like you will always find three questions at least in the exam where it is very difficult to answer. Okay, so questions are drafted in such a manner that you will find it is out of syllabus or like that. So generally this time students were unable to report these type of questions, but my assumption is 5% unsolvable questions or very difficult questions should be there. Okay, now let's start with the easy questions. So what is mean by easy questions? So easy questions are, first of all, topic is easy, the testing area is easy. Example of testing area is say hypothesis testing's basic section, okay, where you are supposed to know what is the null hypothesis and the alternate hypothesis. Okay, so this is the easy area. So easy topic and either medium difficulty level topic. So there are two types of things. Either the topic was easy and no matter what type of question was designed on that easy topic is the first part, first category of the question. Second category is medium difficulty level topic. Generally regression diagnostics, I consider these topics as a medium difficulty level topics, but the questions were easy, like directly regression equation is provided to you and you are supposed to find out the why. Okay, so this means easy questions. So medium difficulty, easy questions, easy topic. If you club this, you get around 30% questions. Okay, so I consider this as a easy part. Now there can be a discrepancy or dispute between the easy and the medium difficulty level. This will depend totally upon the student. Some students will think some questions which I am considering as a difficult are easy questions, and in some cases students reported the questions were difficult, as per them it was difficult, but I consider these questions as easy. Some questions were easy which students were feeling it difficult, because questions were asked in such a manner that you might feel it is tricky, but there was no trick. It is just an additional unnecessary information in your question. The questions were easy. Okay. Next is the difficult. Difficult means difficult question, or the medium difficulty level question means the topic's difficulty. Questions on the medium difficult topic and known tricks. If there are tricks in the question, we will consider those topics as difficult. Tricks as in the very basic tricks. Okay. Not direct question. Direct question as in you saw some question in the illustration and you are getting direct question. I will consider that question as an easy question. If you get that question with slight trick, then I will consider this a medium difficulty level question, because at the end, this is a FRM exam. You are supposed to apply some aptitude here. Okay. And find out the trick and apply that trick in your question. So around 25% questions were medium difficult. Okay. Now third is the difficult. Difficult questions were 30%. Generally this particular portion varies from 30 to 40%, and if it becomes 40%, then we consider this exam as a difficult. Meaning, just see how small difference is there. Instead of 30 questions, if you get 40 difficult questions, we conclude that exam is difficult, because your overall experience of that exam becomes like problematic. You will feel the exam was difficult. Okay, this happens. In difficult area, I consider the topics which are difficult to prepare. Difficult to prepare topics are like you have time series section, which is difficult to understand, fairly difficult to understand. Then you have some students feel option pricing area, binomial, BSM and the Greeks chapters are difficult to understand. Then you have one factor risk matrix, multi-factor risk matrix, which is like the DV01 and key rate duration, all those topics. I consider those topics as difficult to understand on your own. So those topics are difficult, but generally questions are direct or normal questions. But because the topics are difficult to prepare, we will consider these topics, these questions as difficult in the exam. And there are some topics which are easy or normal level or the medium difficulty level, but questions can be drafted in such a manner that it becomes very difficult to answer in the exam. Okay, so those all will be clubbed in this particular part, that is a difficult section. If you just consider this area, 30, 25 and the difficult area. This is around 95%, right? And then you have 5% unsolvable questions, which are very difficult. Like, even if you give me question, I have to think on those questions, because the concepts or the way question is drafted, it is difficult to understand the intent of the drafter, those who are drafting questions, right? So in those cases, you don't have to worry about these questions, because these questions are very difficult. We consider these questions as these questions are not going to impact your result. So your result will be based on these 95% questions, and your major result will be based on this particular section, easy and medium. So easy plus medium accounts for your 55% questions. If you are able to score substantial as in around 95%, again, if you are able to score 95% in these questions, then you have fair chances of clearing the exam. If you are not able to cover this particular section, then there is a problem. And difficult area is not going to decide your result, like as far as I think, but this will decide your quartiles. Like if you are scoring, say, Q1 in particular subject, meaning you fairly manage the difficult questions, and of course you are able to manage easy and the medium level difficulty questions. If you are able to score, say, Q2 or Q3, then we consider like you managed easy questions and medium difficulty level questions, but you were unable to handle the difficult questions. Okay. So what you are supposed to do to handle these type of questions in coming exam? This is for the preparation strategy. Okay, now first is the easy section. In easy section, if you know the concept, if you understand the concept properly, and if you are able to solve the illustrations, okay, you know the illustrations and basic questions, you can easily score in these 30% questions. There were questions which were so easy, like you could have answered just with the understanding of the concept. Okay, so this particular section is very easy to handle with the proper preparation. For this, you have to prepare each and every concept. Generally, these easy questions are from the core area and only from the core area. And again, as we discussed, easy to handle in the exam. Next section is the medium difficulty level. For this part, understanding is important, required, plus your practice is very important. If you practice enough as in not 2000 questions, don't do such thing. Because see, problem with the solving 2000 questions is, if you solve 2000 questions, then you have to revise those 2000 questions before exam, which will be very difficult, right? So make sure you solve around 500 to 700 practical questions or the exam relevant questions. Even if you are able to see, if there is a, say, concept number one, and if you solve two variations of this particular concept, the questions on this particular concept, then chances are you will be able to manage alternate variations. Okay, if you solve like, say, 10 variations, it doesn't matter, because maximum 2 to 3 variations of one particular concept, question on one particular concept, is more than enough for your practice. Rest you are supposed to apply your mind in the exam. Okay, so that's why I'm saying like 500 to 700 questions are good enough for your practice. It will give you enough edge required. Okay. Now next is the difficult area. For the difficult area, again, there are three parts here. One is the understanding. Second is the practice. And third part is your own ability. Okay. That is your own aptitude or logical reasoning level. So if there are very difficult tricks or concepts which are very tricky, so here you need to first make sure you understand those concepts. Understanding the concept will take much time here. Then you have to practice those concepts, and then your own aptitude, the student's aptitude. Okay, so even with the like normal aptitude, you should be able to answer at least 50% of these questions. So after discussing this much, I will discuss the the time management and the relative difficulty. Let's first discuss this particular part. The questions based on type. Okay, so calculative type and theory type. Calculative type were relatively easy compared to the previous exam, and theory was relatively difficult compared to the previous exam. Okay, okay. Now we discuss this much. I will tell you what is the basis of my analysis, because I'm not able to see actual exam. I will not be able to see the results of the students, as in which question they ticked right or which questions they ticked wrong. But we have one particular part, one particular thing here. Okay, we conduct mock test. These are two rounds of mock test, and I set mock test based on the previous exam. Okay, and it is distributed. So I try to match the difficulty level, but generally feedback of the students is I set difficult mock test compared to the actual exam. Then time management is equivalent to your exam, actual exam, and rest is the coverage. Okay, so coverage is really good, like the core concepts are tested more, and the cornered concepts, which are not core concepts, are tested less. So we make sure the coverage is proper, the theory, proportion of theory and the numerical questions is proper. So we try to make sure everything is in order. Only problem is with the difficulty, because here you have say 30% easy questions. I generally keep only 10% easy questions, and I distribute remaining 20% in medium to difficult. Okay, so majorly it is medium and rest are the difficult. Okay, so general exam is say 40-40, and I don't keep unsolvable questions, because I don't know how to how to draft out of syllabus questions. Okay, so I find it very I find this as an injustice for the students. Now remember one thing: once the exam, once the mock test is set in this particular order, students appear for the mock test, and those students who appear for the mock test, I personally review their mock test just to get the idea first how they are able to perform, what is their problem area, and what we can do to solve these problem areas. My general observation is any student who is scoring in between 50 to 60 is able to clear the exam. Okay, and after seeing this, we can see the clear patterns, like what are the problems, because I'm in I talk with the student, I'm able to understand the level of the student, and based on this, that level, I can directly see what question he ticked right, what question he ticked wrong, which question he ticked right and wrong. And based on this, we analyze like what should happen in the actual exam, what should be happening in the actual exam. Generally, because these students are able to clear the exam, those who score 50 or 60 in this particular mock test are able to clear the exam. Meaning, if I see their performance in mock test, that performance should be reflective of the real exam. Okay, and my general observation is students are able to score really good in the easy portion, and then they manage medium area with say 80% accuracy, because this is a mock test. Mock test is conducted 1 month before your exam, and you will see substantial improvement between your mock test and your final exam. And then majority of the students makes mistake in the difficult section, where there are tricks, complications in the question, and there you fail. Okay, so you will not be able to, like, students will not be able to answer the correct option, right? So this tells us what is required for your exam or the preparation, what is required in your preparation to cover or score good in the exam. Now see here, this analysis is based on the mock test and students' feedback, right? And not necessarily the real exam's feedback. Okay, but this gives us the clear idea of how to analyze the actual exam. And I take feedback after the students who appear for the mock test. I take feedback from them of the actual exam and just make sure how was their exam. So generally, if the student scores 50 to 60% in this particular mock test, he is more likely to say that exam was good. And if the student feels the exam is good, then chances are that he will clear the exam, right? So I hope you are able to understand this particular section based on the difficulty level, how you should strategize your preparation for the coming exam. That is, make sure you study from the core area, make sure you practice enough to tackle the medium difficult questions, and don't put too much efforts for the difficult questions, okay, this particular 30% area, because at the end this will melt zero down, or this will end at your own aptitude. Okay, so if your own aptitude is really good, then you will be able to score more. If your own aptitude is fair, then you will score fair. Okay, so your whole preparation should surround or should be focused on this particular part. First, make sure you are good with the easy questions, then make sure you are good with the medium difficulty level questions, and then jump to the difficult questions. Okay, some students, they keep their focus on difficult questions only, and then they make mistake in easy and the medium difficult level portion, and this is a recipe for negative result. Okay, now next is the time management in the exam. So as per the students' feedback, in 2020 session they were able to manage 95% questions in 4 hours, meaning the exam was easy to manage from the perspective of time management. This was just 85% in 4 hours for 2019 session and 80% in 2016 session. Okay, so we can see the trend that exam is now manageable compared in the respect of time. Okay, so you should not be worried about the time management as far as I think. Then we have the FRM part 2 discussion. If you are going to appear for the FRM part 2, then we have really big surprises which were there in this particular exam in 2020 session. Okay, now this part, that is, exam was fairly manageable in 2020 session, and what if the exam is lengthy in your session, say 2021 May session? So this will not affect you much, because if the exam is lengthy, then it is lengthy for everyone. Then it comes to the strategy, how you strategize your 4 hours and which questions you are picking for attempt. Okay, so if you are solving only those questions in which you are good, then you will be able to score properly. The rest you don't have to worry about the time. If you, even if you practice enough, if someone sets exam very lengthy, then like you can improve like 5 to 10 questions, but you cannot substantially cover 100 questions. Okay, of course there will be exception. Some students will be able to manage the 100 questions in the 4 hours irrespective of the length of the question, but this is a general idea, general trend. Now let's move to the FRM part 2's exam review. And if you appeared for the FRM part 2, you know the surprises were exam was very lengthy, and I don't consider exam as difficult compared to the previous exams. Okay, I will tell you the reason for this. So let's first start again. We will follow the same pattern here. So we'll start with the exam pattern, then we will move into the question composition, then we will see the time management. Okay, so you all know market, credit, ops, risk is for the 16 questions, liquidity, investment, 12 questions, current issues, 8 questions. Okay, now the composition of the questions, theory versus calculative. 30%, 60% theory questions, 20% calculative questions. This is common trend. There is no change here. In most of the question exams, this particular calculative area ranges between 18 to 25 or say 26 max. Okay, this is the normal range. And generally, these calculative questions are easy to solve. Okay, so this gives the advantage. If you are able to manage the calculative questions, then you have to just focus on the theory and you have to make sure you are able to get maximum questions. So once you are good with the 20 questions, then say 20, 25 more, and you are more from the theory and you are good to go. Next is the difficulty level. Here, easy questions. I'm just giving you the feedback based on the students. So 8 questions were easy out of 16 in market risk. Easy as in, now see, in FRM part 2, डिफिकल्ट कॉन्सेप्ट प्लस ट्रिक्स प्लस इजी टॉपिक इजी क्वेश्चंस, एवरीथिंग कम्स अंडर द इजी क्वेश्चंस, ओके. यू कैन नॉट कंप्लेन इन एफआरएम पार्ट टू दैट टॉपिक वाज डिफिकल्ट बिकॉज यू ऑलरेडी पास द एफआरएम पार्ट वन, सो वी नो दैट यू हैव समथिंग इनसाइड यू, सो यू कैन अंडरस्टैंड द डिफिकल्ट कॉन्सेप्ट, राइट. यू पास एफआरएम पार्ट वन मीन्स यू आर गुड विथ हैंडलिंग द ट्रिक्स एंड ऑफकोर्स इजी क्वेश्चंस आर इजी क्वेश्चंस फॉर एवरीवन. So, irrespective of it is difficult, tricky or easy questions, we consider these as easy. Okay. Now, tricks includes the basic tricks. It is not like the question which are drafted in very complicated language. In FRM part 2, the tricks are generally with the calculatory questions and most of the students are able to manage the calculatory questions. Meaning, most of the students are able to handle those tricks. That's it. And then there are difficult area, because you are in FRM part 2, students are able to prepare the difficult area and they're able to score it, right? So based on this, market risk 8 questions, that is known area, irrespective of difficult or not, known area, known type of questions and so on will be here in 8 questions. In credit risk, students reported only 4. I personally think it should be around 6, but let's assume it is 4. Ops plus liquidity accounts for 8 easy questions. So questions like repo, Basel, and the basic areas. Okay, so liquidity's basic chapters, all those are in these 8 questions. Okay, and rest of the story, if you appeared for the exam, you know what was the problem. Problem was all the concepts were mixed. Okay, so ops, liquidity, credit risk, everything was entangled with each other, and then those type of questions are difficult questions. Those type of questions are not the easy questions. Okay, but the basic questions are easy questions. Liquidity, then investment risk. 6 questions were easy, mainly because in investment risk you have the proper calculative area, and there is a limitation to draft question on this. Majorly like the concepts like alpha, factor theory, then hedging. So all those questions were easy. Right, and the performance analysis, these are the easy. In current issues, as always, 7 questions were easy out of 8, if and only if you remember the key concepts. Okay, you have to make sure you remember the key concept in your preparation if you are going to appear for the coming exam May 2021 exam, then make sure you have short notes prepared. Don't dive deep into the concept because these are the current issues. For every current issues, you will have like substantial resources available on the internet. Okay. If you try to just say example, this time the first chapter of the current issues was the Bitcoins. Okay. Blockchain technology. Now, if you try to study the blockchain, and if you try to get the proper understanding of each and every part of it, it should take around 2 days for you. Okay. Because for every concept, there are background concepts. For every background concept, there are again the further concepts, right? So instead of doing all those things, just make sure that you remember the key concepts according to the learning outcome. So there is a learning outcome. According to learning outcome, say these are the 4 key concepts. Just remember those 4 key concepts, irrespective of you understand it or you don't understand it. See, GAAP's intention is not to make sure you understand the concept, because say you have machine learning in your syllabus. GAAP is not expecting you to be machine learning expert in the exam. GAAP just wants you to know something about the machine learning. So if you know the key concepts, definitely you can score or pick the right answer. And of course, there will be one question which is tricky one. Okay. And again, irrespective of which book you choose, it is not going to affect your score as long as you remember the key concept. This point you're supposed to remember. I will just give you the quick idea. Okay. So market risk is generally tested on the core area. Make sure you prepare the core area and don't focus on the corner concepts. Credit risk, it is totally diversified, but still you get around 50% exam on the core area, remaining 50% from the small concepts or not the core concepts. So what are the core concepts? I will give the quick idea. In the credit risk measure chapter, in credit risk book, you have credit risk measures. In that chapter, you have probability of default calculation, the distance to default calculation, right? So I consider these two or three similar topics as a core area. Remaining portion of that chapter is considered as a non-core area. Okay, so make sure you prepare core area first. I'm not saying don't prepare the non-core area, but you have to make sure you are absolutely good or excellent in the core area, which accounts for only 30% of syllabus in any subject. Okay, first make sure you are good with the 30% syllabus and then invest your time in the remaining area. Again, how to do this? First, you will read chapter like a normal student, like start with the chapter one, start with the first page, finish till the last page, identify the core areas, make sure you are good with the core areas. Now come to the non-core areas. If you think that non-core area is taking more time or much time for you, then just remember the key points and move on. Right now, just star mark it, okay? And then move on to the next section. Then keep doing this, and once you are done with the core area, you will have some extra time left. In that time, just start with your non-core area. See which are those non-core areas where you are finding difficulties, and try to solve those difficulties as much as possible. With this type of preparation, this style of preparation, you will get one particular advantage. The advantage is, first, you will be good with the substantial testable area in the exam. And rest of the section, you will be like any other student. So what is the clear edge here? Edge is you are good with the core area, meaning you will score good in, automatically score better compared to the other students. And you are like every other student in the non-core area. So it is not going to affect your performance, right? In FRM exam, remember, this is a competitive exam, okay? So in some area, you have to be like the others. In some area, you have to be better than the others. If you are better than the others and that area is testable in the exam, automatically you will score really good in the exam compared to the other students. That's the clear line for every competitive exam. Okay, you are not expected to know 100% of the syllabus and 100% of the concepts with the 100% clarity, because see, cutoff is generally like, say, 50 to 60%. I'm just giving you the rough idea here. Rough idea as an example, not even a rough idea here. So in this 50% portion, GAAP is expecting you to make mistake in the 50% section. GAAP knows that students will make 50% mistakes. So based on this, you have to strategize your preparation. Don't bother about not preparing 100%. Bother about not preparing core areas with 100% accuracy. Okay. Then next is difficult questions. Now, what were the difficult questions? So this time you got case studies. Last time, as far as I remember, GARP asked case studies in the FRM part 2 exam. That is a lengthy case studies I'm talking about, a full page case studies I'm talking about, is 2016 May. Okay. In this exam, GARP asked case studies, substantial, like around 15 to 20 numbers of case studies. And after this, GAAP stopped asking case studies because of no case study situation in the exam. This exam was manageable from the time management perspective. Okay. So if you ask any, if you have any known person who appeared for, say, 2019 exam, you'll get to know that exam was manageable from the time perspective. Exam was difficult in this relation, okay? So 40% approximately medium to easy questions, and okay, so medium to difficult questions 50% and difficult questions 50% in this manner. But time management was not the issue for previous exams, previous 4 to 5 exams, okay? Now, what type of questions are included in this particular area? First of all, questions where case studies are involved. I personally think there is no way to prepare for the case studies with 100% accuracy. That you cannot plan that you are going to score 100% in the case study. You can give your best shot, remember the key concept, understand the concepts like this, and just sit in the exam and then see how you can manage those case studies. Okay. Even if you study, say, from GAAP or any other book, you are going to face a similar situation in this difficult area. Okay. So your goal should be reduce your preparation time for this particular portion, like in theory portion. The difficult area majorly constitutes a theory section, theory of credit, mark, credit risk, liquidity, operational risk, like that. Second type of questions were, where these are mainly theory questions, where you cannot tick the right answer. In this situation, you have like only one way out. The one only way out is eliminate the two and take the best guess in the remaining two. Again, the same situation, A, B, C, D. Maybe say use, after reading the question, you are able to eliminate the two. Take the best guess in one of these two. If your concepts are clear, if you remember the concepts, automatically this accuracy will improve. That is, elimination's accuracy will improve. And once your elimination's accuracy is improved, you get the 50% probability of ticking the right answer. Okay? Meaning 50% of 40 difficult questions. And this does not mean that if the student is able to like prepare like all 40 plus these 50 is still in the problem. Okay? This is a clear line. Clear line is, irrespective of the difficult and easy questions, you are likely to clear the exam. So strategize your preparation in this particular manner. My recommendation is, use short notes for all theory topics. Okay, no matter what is the theory topic, prepare your short notes, or if you're taking classes, then you will get the short notes. But prepare your short notes, make sure you are handy with the short notes before your exam. And just 5 to 6 days before the exam, use those short notes only. Don't bother about reading the full text. Even if you try to read the full text, problem is, it is difficult to remember that particular text in the exam. Okay, so to solve that problem, make sure at least you remember the key concept so that your elimination becomes more accurate. And the last part is the time management. So really bad, like in 2019 exam, all 80 questions were manageable in 4 hours. 2020 session was very lengthy. I should write very lengthy. Okay. So my guess is at like 80% questions were manageable in, this is just a guess because we don't get complete feedback for FRM part 2 the way we get the feedback for FRM part 1. So I guess around 80% should be like, questions should be manageable in the 4 hours. And same situation was there in 2016 session. Okay. The exam used to be lengthy. Now, in 2019, it was manageable. Now again, it is lengthy. Okay. One more issue. In preparation, don't bother about the time management of the exam. Okay. For part 1, for part 2, both. Please don't bother about it. Just bother about time management in revision schedule. Okay. If you are able to manage that part, there are fair chances that you will be able to clear the exam. And for all the students who appeared, that's the end of the discussions. Okay. And for all the students who appeared for the exam, all the best. I wish you very good luck. I hope all you all clear the exam. Okay. So that's all. That's all about the exam review of FRM part 1 and part 2 for 2020 session. See you in the next video. Thank you very much.